Thank you very much, Program Director, and good evening to all who are in South Africa. Probably it's good day in America, but some parts of America, the time differs. So, and also good evening to all those who have linked through the Facebook and also on Zoom. Honorable Church de Affairs, Mr. Todd Haskell, your wife, dear colleagues, dear guests. On behalf of the government of the people of the Republic of South Africa, I greet all of you who have joined us this evening. Whilst the COVID-19 pandemic has forced us to gather in a rather unique way, it could not prevent us from celebrating with you the 245th anniversary of the founding of the United States of America. We are delighted to reflect with you on the date of 2nd July 1776, when the Continental Congress voted in favor of independence, and when 2 days later, delegation from the 13 colonies adopted the Declaration of Independence, a historic document drafted by Thomas Jefferson. From 1776 to the present day, the 4th of July has been celebrated as the birth of the American nation. As South Africans, your struggle for independence and freedom resonates with us, and we will be remiss not to express how very much aware and grateful you were as South Africans, as a South African nation, for the support given to our own liberation movement by the people of the United States. And I was telling the ambassador too that one of my colleagues I was at school with left for exile in 1977, just a year after the Soweto uprisings, and had ended up getting a scholarship through the African National Congress in the United States. He's one of the top physicists in the country specializing in nuclear, but there are quite a number of them, the artists, the musicians, the humor seekers, the Miriam Makevas, you mentioned them. They were just there as hosted by yourselves. We are particularly grateful for the role played by the great African Americans, such as Reverend Leon Sullivan, whose Sullivan principles developed in 1977, applied economic pressures on South Africa in protest of the then system of apartheid. These principles eventually gained wide adoption among United States corporations with investments in apartheid, which led to a groundswell of disinvestment and the weakening of the apartheid government. This evening, we are very pleased to state that since 1994, the bilateral relations between the United States and South Africa have gone from strength to strength. Our political and economic relations are, my apology, I think I should take out the mic so that they can see my face. I'm already used to speak through the lawn. This evening we are pleased to state that since 1994, the bilateral relations between the United States and South Africa have gone from strength to strength. Our political and economic relations are conducted at the highest levels of government, both on a bilateral and multilateral level, whilst the sectors in both countries continue to show faith and confidence in the economic futures of both nations through increasing trade and investment. I have been informed that more than 600 U.S. companies have now found a home in South Africa, and we thank you very much to look at South Africa as an investment destination. As South Africa's third largest trading partner and largest source of development aid, the United States is a key and valued partner. I'm happy to report that trade between our two countries is a two-way street, with a flow delivering considerable benefits for both countries. More than 25% of United States trade with the African continent is in South Africa. As both countries and the global economy starts to slow, recovery from the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic and subsequent global breakdowns, we look forward to increasing the economic activities between our countries as we build together. The president of our two countries, the presidents of the two countries recently met at the margins of the G7 in Britain, while our foreign ministers are also having regular discussions on a host of challenges facing the global community, arguably two most important being the COVID-19 pandemic and climate change issues. And I'm glad that we have already announced the vaccines that will be delivered to South Africa soon, and we hope they do arrive so that we could really save the lives of our own people. It will also be appropriate tonight to echo the appreciation expressed by President Ramaphosa for the support we have found in the Biden administration for South Africa, India initiative to see the limit waiving of trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights in the at the World Trade Organization. We thank you for that. The waiver will allow for the local production for a certain period of time of the current most effective vaccines to become accessible to all. The availability of these vaccines will ensure that large numbers of people are vaccinated and that countries' borders will be open for trade and tourism that much sooner, thus ensuring the global economy, of which we are all part, will grow and we will all benefit from it. There's a growing global support for this initiative and the new held by the both Presidents Ramaphosa and President Biden that no one is safe from this pandemic until everyone is safe. And you said that, Charge de Affair. The return of the current United States administration to multilateralism and the expression of the solidarity with the global community through the many programs announced by President Biden, e.g. the commitment to the World Health Organization and its COVID-19 programs benefits us all. The United States leadership on climate change and the recently held summit hosted by President Biden in Washington, as well as the G7, gives the global community, particularly the smaller countries and those in Africa which are not and have not been large emitters of greenhouse gases, but which suffer from the climate change through drought, floods, fires, and other disasters, hope that the solidarity expressed by the developed countries will improve their situation and lives. I am sure these two issues will be further discussed at the G20 later this year, and that with the support of the major economies, solutions can be found. Dear friends, as President Mandela once said, a country cannot be an island of poverty in a sea of poverty. Let me repeat it again. A country cannot be an island of prosperity in a sea of poverty, close quote. The responsibility of international solidarity to address not only the global pandemic and climate change, but also the other global challenges such as poverty, unemployment, and inequality rests with all of us. Focusing on the health and well-being of our people is aided by a global economic recovery, which benefits all and can only provide a better world for all of us to live in it. Resources for addressing the challenges of poverty and development, as set out by the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, has of necessity been diverted to combat the COVID-19 pandemic. As a global community and as a human beings, we should be doing our best to assist those who are less fortunate than ourselves in whatever way we can do. We cannot prosper while the majority of our fellow human beings are left out in the cold and to fend for themselves. As President Mandela also said, and I quote, "For to be free is not merely to cast off one's own chains, but to live in a way that respects and enhances the freedom of others," close quote. As two major role players in the world regionally, South Africa and United States have a responsibility to assist whoever we can. We are pleased to note that both countries have a history and tradition of doing just that. In conclusion, please allow me to again congratulate the United States of America on celebrating the 245th anniversary of the independence of the United States of America. I thank you very much, Hoskin, for really hosting us today and for us to be able to deliver this message to all. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.